In this video, I will be covering the transformation of a flat voxel world into a seemingly spherical planet. I will not be talking about the impossibility of making the planet behave like a normal planet and why it is still possible to build a train track that goes all around it. If you haven't seen my previous video on that topic, I'd recommend you to click here and watch that first. In order to discuss this transformation, we will look at the cross-section of the planet. I will be representing this cross-section as a grid of blocks. Let's establish a coordinate system first. I will call this blue line the sea level of the planet, height 0. It is close to the planet's surface. X will be the height above the sea level. Y will be the horizontal position of the voxel on the flat plane, and RP will be the radius of the planet. After transforming the flat plane to a spherical world, I will use polar coordinates and call the height above the planet center H, and the center angle will be called phi. Please keep in mind that I am measuring the center angle clockwise, which is against convention, but it makes this explanation simpler. I will also be using tilde x and tilde y as Cartesian coordinates after the transformation, with the origin at the planet's center. Now, the naive approach would be to just preserve the total height after the transformation and base the center angle on the horizontal position of the block, so that distances on the circle are equal to distances on a flat plane. This means phi will be 360 degrees or 2 pi, times the fraction of the distance from the origin of the coordinate system to the total planet circumference. Writing the planet circumference as 2 pi times rp, this gives phi equals y over rp. Having h and phi, we can now just apply the commonly known functions for transforming from polar to Cartesian coordinates. However, when applying this transformation to the flat plane, the blocks on the top get stretched and the ones close to the center get squashed. When looking at the cross-section, this makes the house and tree look very weird. The same thing can be observed in the game. This TNT block sits on top of a tree on a mountain and is therefore stretched. And while this cave looks normal up here, it starts to get really weird the further down you get. In order to fix this, we need a transformation that preserves the aspect ratio of the voxels. Using h as the height on the planet again, we know that this condition is met if the height per block, delta h, equals the block's width, w. Since x is the height above the sea level, it describes the number of blocks in the stack on the left. Delta h, being the height per block, can also be written as just that, the height dh per block dx. This gives us dh over dx equals w. But how do we know the width of any block w? Let's start by just arbitrarily defining that the blocks at the planet's surface will have width 1. If we want to know any other width w, we can deduce it from the fact that the proportions w to h and 1 to rp must be the same. Therefore, w can be expressed as h over rp. Now, let's combine the two formulas we have for w. As you can see, we get this differential equation here. Luckily, this is easy to solve by integration. Assuming that sea level is at the radius of the planet, we get this exponential function as a new solution for h. Now, let's combine that with what we already know. We have the polar to Cartesian transformation function, as well as equations for h and phi. Combining all these together, we get this monstrous solution. Now, at this point, you might start to realize something. we have two dimensions, something with the exponential function, and trigonometric functions. If only there was some kind of two-dimensional number system where the exponential function was somehow related to trigonometric functions. If you are thinking of complex numbers, you're on the right track. Instead of a 2D vector, let's write this equation in a complex basis. Actually, this doesn't really seem much simpler, but maybe this part here sounds familiar to you. This section can be simplified using Euler's identity. Now, the equations look a lot more manageable, but we can do even better. Let's use complex numbers instead of two separate coordinates. Let's call this complex position before the transformation set. And call the position after the transformation tilde set. This way, we get this extremely simple and beautiful solution for the transformation. In the complex plane, the result looks like this. And here's the transformation applied to the cross section. In the game, the TNT block looks perfectly normal now. Basically, when previously looking at the slice of the planet, we were only ever looking at the real axis. If only we had looked to the sides, we might have realized that there's a whole other imaginary dimension and that the slice lives in the complex plane. The exponential function preserving the aspect ratio wasn't just a lucky coincidence, this is actually an implication of the exponential function being holomorphic. Being holomorphic means that for all complex numbers set 0, the complex derivative of the function exists. This may not sound like a very strong condition, since a function being differentiable on the reals is very common. For complex numbers though, this implies that the derivative is the same, no matter where you approach set 0 from. Assuming the derivative is non-zero, holomorphic functions preserve angles. Orthogonal lines stay orthogonal, but that was also the case in our first approach. Now we can use the fact that the derivative is the same in all directions. In a very basic way, you could imagine the derivative as the frequency of crossing grid lines. Since the right angle between the grid lines is preserved and grid lines cross with the same frequency in both directions, we can conclude that the resulting image preserves the aspect ratio of infinitesimally small rectangles. Of course, the exponential function is not the only holomorphic function. You could also imagine something like this. But given the conditions that a function must furl the complex plane around the origin and preserve aspect ratios, we can show that c times e to the power of z is the only solution. The constant c can represent arbitrarily stretching a plane as well as rotating it, since c may be complex. Notice how the aspect ratio doesn't change. If you're wondering why c times e to the power of z is the only solution, see the description for another derivation of this function. Please keep in mind that I just happen to be interested in making a spherical box world, I am not a mathematician. If you think I'm wrong about something I showed you in this video, there's a significant chance you know more than me. In that case, please let me know in the comments so that I can correct the error.